I'm Steven Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today, a production of the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today we'll be talking about free speech on campus. Robert O'Neill is a former president of the University of Virginia, founder of the Thomas Jefferson Center for the Protection of Free Expression, and author of the book, Academic Freedom in the Wired World. Dmitry Dubrovsky is a fellow at the National Endowment for Democracy, and until recently was director of the Human Rights Program at St. Petersburg State University in Russia. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, maybe if we could start with, why is freedom of expression so important on a university campus?
Right now, I'd say it's about as important and as potentially contentious as it's ever been. These are interesting times. Let me just offer a couple of observations about free speech on campus. For one thing, the law of the United States is really unique among even developed Western nations. Our approach, which is essentially hands-off both for public and for private institutions, is quite different, let's say, even from the situation in Canada. Canadian institutions do regulate hate speech and other epithets and so on in a way that we simply don't do. So I think the first point to make is that the United States is, if not completely unique, there are a few times when Australian law gets in the way, but for the most part, as I said, even Canada is quite different, and in that sense, we're unique.
And you're here from Russia. So, Dmitry, so do you think that the United States is that unique relative to Russian universities?
Well, Russia is a part of the other Western countries. As Bob said, it's also the more or less followed the Nuremberg legacy, because as all of us know that in Nuremberg, the journalist Julius Streicher was executed just because his personal contribution into the Holocaust. Although he read a lot of the anti-Semitic statements in his newspaper, Stürmer. And I believe the Soviet Union and then Russia more or less follow this tradition of the persecution for the warts, but I would say warts crime. Yeah. So this is the partly covered in the universities too, and the, because of university as a public place, also more or less covered, of course, they covered the principles of the Russian Constitution, which is limited freedom of speech.
Well, in terms of freedom of speech, when it seems to me that it's easy to have discussions about freedom of speech when you're not offending anybody. So if we're having general discussions about whether or not your ties are beautiful or they're not beautiful, no one really cares, with all due respect to your ties. But when we start talking about contentious public policy issues, people very much do care. And Bob, I was struck by one of the points you made in your book about the professor in Colorado who claimed that the people who died in 9/11 deserved to die, and you were taking the position that it was okay for this professor to speak, and I was a little surprised by that.
In fact, the University of Colorado administration and eventually even the governing board agreed that he was within his rights as a speaker to comment on an issue of public importance. Now, in the end, he was ousted from his position, his faculty tenured position, for a totally different reason, because he had engaged in research misconduct. So a completely different faculty committee at the University of Colorado Boulder eventually recommended to the Board of Trustees that they remove him from his position, which happened. But insofar as his outrageous statements, he was fully protected, and the same has been true, for example, a notable Holocaust denier who has been on the faculty at Northwestern University for 35 years. Five Northwestern University presidents have found his speech protected, outrageous, offensive, and among other things, totally false. He argues that 6 million Jews either took their own lives or were victims of an epidemic or in some other way, that there was no Holocaust in effect. Well, he is free as long as he continues to teach in his subject area. He is free, five presidents have said so, to continue these outrageous untruths.
But why should that be? So let's assume that I was the vice mayor of a city or I was a public official. Why do university professors have a different protection?
Actually, it's not clear that they do. For public employees, as distinguished from those who work in corporations in the private sector who really have very little constitutional protection, but those who work in the public sector have government jobs, they have a substantial measure of free speech, First Amendment protection. Maybe not quite as much as academics do, but nonetheless, for the last 35, almost 40 years, that's been true. And the Supreme Court, interestingly, Supreme Court goes back and forth on all sorts of issues, whether it's same-sex marriage or whatever. The Supreme Court has never wavered in its commitment to protect the free speech of public officials, including but not limited to college and university professors.
And what about people who work at universities who aren't professors?
As public employees, they are also protected, curiously. Now, it may not matter a lot to a dining hall cook or a truck driver or a groundskeeper. It's not likely that somebody like that is going to run into trouble. But if it happens, and if somebody speaks out, and occasionally it does happen, then the courts have been very clear that even a non-academic person is substantially, I won't say totally, there are exceptions. For example, if you take too much time away from the job, or if somebody displays just incompetence, okay. But short of exceptions like that, even the groundskeeper or the cook or the trash hauler is substantially protected under our First Amendment.
But doesn't the cook in some way represent the campus in terms of basic behavior? You know, we expect people to be polite to one another. We try to prevent hate speech. I mean, there are things that people can do that really can make other people angry. So shouldn't an entity like a university be able to kind of reprimand somebody for behaving in an inappropriate way?
Only in fairly extreme cases. Otherwise, and there have been quite a few court decisions which reinforce that notion and that degree of protection. But otherwise, at least since the late 1960s, that has been the universal view of courts, both federal and state, under the Supreme Court's doctrine.
Well, fair enough. And in terms of Dmitry, you come from Russia. Obviously, there's a whole different political tradition in Russia. Where do you come down on some of these things that we're talking about?
Well, first of all, the question of the, well, hate speech do not exist in the Soviet Union, because although we have the special article in the Russian Soviet Crime Code, it's never had been implemented to anybody. Because, of course, the Soviet Union was the paradise for all the inter-ethnic and religious relations. That's why it's, although it was put into the criminal court in the after the Second World War, I mean the criminal court against the article against the hate speech. But for now, the situation quite different, because the turbulences, the political turbulences of the Russia in the beginning of the 90s, the existence of the new independent Russia, the collapse of Soviet Union, it's all the inter-ethnic and religious tensions in late Soviet Union and the Russia. And of course, the number of people with the different political views, they were and are their college university professors. And it's the question remains for now, what is their liability for their speech? because in Russia, in principle, a public speech could be protected only if they do not consist of the different so-called elements of the currently defined as extremism. If you're speaking on the, for example, the Holocaust deniers, or the, you're speaking something bad about the different nationalities or religion, you could be punished, well, from the fine to the serious amount of time in prison. So, and for the professors, for the universities, it's also the serious question of autonomy, the university's autonomy. And unfortunately, so what's had happened right now, what had happened in the 90s and what is going on right now, the most of the victims of this legislation, mostly not the people from the hatred group, but mostly the oppositioners of the civil rights activists who can easily lose their position because of the, for example, the one of the, it wasn't the case of academics, but it was a journalist who was punished because he was accused on the dissemination of the hate of the social group like power, political power of Tatarstan is one of the Republic of Russian Federation. And one of the biggest issue for Russia for now is the limitation of freedom of speech on behalf of security and social peace. And this is the, in particular, this is the serious case of the academia, when the academia already had a serious legacy of the Soviet Union, when it was all the academic freedoms were oppressed and limited. That's the current situation is mostly self-censorship.
And since you're teaching at, or you have been at Bard College in New York State, do you, obviously there's a difference between St. Petersburg State University and Bard College, but do you notice some self-censorship on the part of faculty members at Bard?
Never. That's maybe this Bard, might be where Bard College is unique from the on the American perspective. I am not very much acquainted with the other colleges, but the Bard College looks very free, even the very harsh discussion about the, for example, personality of president and his personal contribution. That is very open, even more open than I could imagine, to be honest. But there seems to me very, very important to this is the matter for everyone, the freedom of speech. Yeah. This is the concern and the everyday concern of the not only faculty members, but the students or the other employers, employee. So this is, seems to me very important because of the kind of common value of the college.
Fair enough. And Bob, if you could say a word or two about self-censorship.
Yeah, Bard is, of course, in many ways unique. I guess we could say that since the president has outlived virtually all of the faculty whom he initially recruited. He is subject to outrageous slings and arrows, I suppose. Let me add two qualifications that I think need recognition. If we take the case of, say, a foreign language professor in Romance languages, he or she is entitled to come into the faculty dining room and say, in all seriousness, "I just know the earth is flat. Columbus was just lucky when he sailed out there. Really, it's flat." If he says that, he probably won't have many friends coming by for lunch, but he is protected as long as he continues to serve and teach and write in his discipline. If, however, the flat earth expert happens to be a geographer or a geologist, forget it. Under those circumstances, any governing board or administration would dismiss the person for incompetence, as in a geographer or a geologist is required to know that the earth is not flat. Now, let me add one other very quick qualification. There are a number of situations in which either speech is unprotected, child pornography, for example, criminal conspiracy, fraud, solicitation. It's either unprotected or sometimes it's just deemed non-speech, even though it may involve words. But just conveying words without more, or conveying certain kinds of images, as in child pornography, that's not necessarily protected. But those are sort of the the two outposts are outliers, and everything else in between, including what goes on at the faculty dining room at Bard, I'm sure, is widely protected.
And you were general counsel, if I'm not mistaken, for the AAUP.
Three times, yes.
So if you could say a word or two about what AAUP does and what your role was in a little more detail.
This happens to be a particularly important moment because the 100th anniversary of the American Association of University Professors is coming up in about 6 weeks. The various statements, starting with the original statement in 1915 and on through 1940 and into the 50s, not only has AAUP really uniquely been a guardian or protector of academic freedom in a way that no other faculty organization has ever quite been able to do, but they have also been very tough even on their own people. There have been several cases, for example, in which the national AAUP has actually imposed censure on a chapter of its own organization for violating its basic cardinal rules and principles. The other thing that's unique as we enter the centennial year is that AAUP never asks a beleaguered or troubled faculty member whether he or she is a member. They just serve the professoriate and don't ask. If the case comes out well, it would be nice to ask the person. I've actually done this several times, and on a couple of occasions they said, no, that's okay, thanks. I'm glad we were able to help, but you go on your way. That's unique to AAUP, and it's an extraordinary organization.
Do you do anything to protect students?
I wish we did more. And actually, what has happened at the University of Oklahoma in the last 2 or 3 weeks is highly indicative. When former governor, senator, and now University of Oklahoma president David Boren expelled 4 students who had engaged in an outrageously racist rant in a fraternity bus, we in the First Amendment academic freedom community were sharply divided. I tend to believe that President Boren was right, he was justified. But I have a lot of good friends, colleagues, and academic freedom junkies who take a very different view and say, no, we just don't do that. If it's hate speech, which it was, we protect it nonetheless, even under those circumstances. I would say, David Boren, the same would be true of Father Ted Hesburgh, for example. When he was president of Notre Dame, he once said, you have 5 minutes in which to disperse. And needless to say, the Notre Dame students all dispersed. But I think it takes a Ted Hesburgh or a David Boren to come down with an edict of that sort that is likely to change behavior, and therefore I go with it.
Why shouldn't there be more protection for students then? Because if the community of believers, for lack of a better term, is divided, it seems to me that there ought to be more protections for students.
We do protect students' rights to participate in organizations, for example. This is particularly true in the public sector, in the private sector. It's much more complicated, and basically students in private or independent institutions have very few constitutional or comparable rights. But students in the public sector do have substantial protections, and I think should, but they are constitutional much more than just regulatory.
And I wanted to shift a little bit to the issue of responsibility. Mm-hmm. Some people argue that this discussion is all about rights and not about responsibilities. And don't students and professors and public employees have a responsibility to act in a particular way that is professional? And if Professor Jones or Smith or student Jones or Smith doesn't behave in a particular way, then there's nothing outrageous about asking them to leave.
I would say this is a serious violation of principles of our academia, because I believe the pillar of the academia is the Institute of Reputation and Professional Ethic, but not the legal regulations like the criminal or even administrative punishment. Because that's very difficult to let's take these memorial laws in Europe like a good explanation why even the Holocaust deniers who are already has been punished, they could be protected even by the constitution of these countries, because who could identify what is the limits, what is possible to say, for example, about the Holocaust? If we are the even especially academia should have additional privileges to discuss, let's say, numbers of victims. Well, for example, when I say officially the 6 million is not the proper number of victims, because they was calculated late after the Second World War, there were the sociological tools. In reality, there may be the number of victims a little bit less. But do I should be punished for as a Holocaust deniers or not? So that seems to me that all the regulations, they should be more or less regulate the principles outside of the academic community. I mean legal regulations. I believe they're very much in the Institute of Reputations. And by the way, this is the interesting question about these cases, what Bob has mentioned about this at Oklahoma, because how about the reputation of this institute? If this already publicly announced that it was expelled, it's interesting. I would believe more in the university who expelled the students for their racial jokes and racial attacks. And I would think about, should I send my children to the university? Is this university protecting the people who organized the racist attack to the people?
Yeah.
But the other issue, on the other side of that, and then I'd love to hear your thought about this, Bob, is the issue of, does a mom or a dad really feel comfortable sending their student to a university where their kids are going to be in a hostile situation?
I agree with Dmitry, I think, entirely, up to the point where I'd add one qualification. I think the context, protective context with respect to parents, the relatives, classmates, and so on, I think there is rather limited protection, but it does get us into the area of responsibility. If a Holocaust denier, for example, simply publishes his or her views on the Holocaust, and they are manifestly false, they're offensive, we've already dealt with that. But if a Holocaust denier, in the course of publishing his or her views, disparages the views of an academic colleague, that we tend not to allow. And though I have never seen a case that actually addresses disparaging a colleague's views with regard to an issue as offensive and intrusive as the Holocaust, I think most of us would agree that that's where a line could be drawn. It's just that, unfortunately, I can't come up with a case that's ever happened. But in terms of responsibility, I think we should do a better job. And we all agree that we do a great job on rights, but not such a great job on responsibilities. But I think in dealing with such volatile issues, I think particularly the notion of protecting against disparagement of a colleague's views, I think that's just crossing the line.
Fair enough. We only have a few minutes left, but I thought it was fair to point out, Bob, you have the same name as the Navy SEAL.
Yes.
Who allegedly shot and killed Osama bin Laden.
Yep. I'm not sure I can claim any credit, but I did want to pass along for our general consumption a fascinating international experience. I attended the annual meeting about 25 years ago of the International Association of Universities in Manila. And there I came across and spent a fascinating afternoon with the rector of the University of Irkutsk. And we immediately identified one another because of our proximity to what in my case was the biggest lake. And he then turned around pointing to Lake Baikal and said, "Yes, but ours is much deeper than yours." And we went on talking about what we did in Great Lakes and Lake Baikal research programs. I wish I could have replicated that experience, and someday I'm going to go to Irkutsk. And while my colleague may have long since retired, I don't know, but that experience is one that transcends about everything else we're talking about.
In what way?
I think it brings people together on shared views. And Dmitry, your experience at BART, your view of American private higher education will never be the same once you go back to St. Petersburg or anywhere else, because you've had exposure, as I have had, to German and other institutions. And I think, I know, Steve, you've had some excellent programs on internationalization, globalization. When it comes to speech, as different as our laws are in this country, there is a transcendent commitment to expression as a value that crosses international and various other boundaries.
Well, gentlemen, we're going to have to leave it at that. Thank you both. If you would like additional information about Robert O'Neill or Dmitry Dubrovsky, please visit law.virginia.edu or ned.org. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at highereducationtoday@topcolleges.com. Thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Steven Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.